I was thinking that he had made a big overplay. There goes Chris Limo stacking it in. Real name Yervand. He's from Sunnyside, Queens. He's a business owner, and he's married, and he's got two daughters that he loves very much. And he, I believe, made the final table of the last live stream in this. Yeah. Is that right, guys?
Yeah, yeah, we talked about that already. It's amazing.
Yeah, he got in the 2 million. He got through just thousands of players to make the live stream final table. He came up short. He busted. He was one of the first people to bust. And here he is again, stacking handfuls of green chips.
You said he's a business owner. His nickname, Chris Limo, is that, does he own a limo business?
Yeah,
that,
yeah.
Sounds like
that. He's in the limo business. Seen him today when we were walking to go get some food right before the tournament started. And he said that he wasn't that excited and he wasn't nervous at all.
Pretty amazing.
And he looks like he's just having a good time. He doesn't look like nervous. He looks like he's relaxed, but it seems to be relaxed.
Maybe if we say some nice things about him, we can get a ride back to the Philly airport on him, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he should take care of us. He's
a really good-looking guy. Look at him go.
Oh, absolutely.
I'm raising it again.
He's raising, but we don't know what with.
So we are going to say goodbye to Drew Gonzalez in 10th, $9,708. Great job, Drew.
Yeah.
Sure he will be back. And
yeah, it's tough to come to the final table and be the first one out in 10th place, but someone's got to go.
Yep.
You know, it's a $400 tournament, you know, cashing for...
You got to give Chris some credit. He played that hand pretty deceptively, checked back the turn with the nuts, and I think that's what got him paid on the river.
Yeah, absolutely.
If he bet the turn, you know, a sizable amount, Drew may have just folded, so...
Yeah,
good
Chris,
for Chris. He played it.
Chris played it like a KG vet. And he got him. At first, I thought that that Andrew had all the chips and that it was like a big overbet or something. But seeing that he had 18 blinds,
right?
Then it just seemed like a really good play. Nothing crazy at all, but he did it deceptive and he soaked him.
So this is David D. Benardi, nicknamed Debo. He's also from Ohio. We got two guys from Ohio at this table: Joey Cooten and David. And it sounds like David's been playing poker for 2 years. Single. His hobbies are sports, poker, friends, and chilling. And looks like he usually plays at the Tampa Hard Rock. And his previous biggest score was 22,000. So a lot.
This will be his biggest score.
Yeah,
a couple spots.
A lot of people today are actually playing for their biggest scores ever. So.
Yeah.
There's only a couple of guys here that have played for this type of money before, Chris Limo being one of them, and Joey Cooten and David Jackson being the other two.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a big spot for most of the guys here today, so it should be interesting to see.
Even for a guy like David Jackson and Cooten, these are huge spots.
Yeah.
Like, these are the kind of scores that you they come few and far between in our career, and try to like seize the moment when you get there. So I know they're looking to close out. Here comes Chris again. We can see his whole cards this time. Last hand, there was a bet and a three bet. We couldn't see what was going on, but here. Here we can see that he's open king queen off. Just over a min raise.
So I'm seeing the YouTube comments here, but they don't have it set up so we can respond in the YouTube comments. So I'll just I'll try to do that. You know, just by responding to you guys verbally. Looks like David Jackson has a friend here, Jacob Treba, who didn't know his girlfriend was pregnant, and he's pretty happy about it. And other people are talking about how that baby is going to be an awesome poker player. So Zara must be Zara. Okay,
yeah.
Zara must be a good player too. If these guys are saying the baby is going to be one hell of a player.
Oh wow, and that's the comments came in. They didn't know until we said it on
right. Yeah, that's what I got. So we're making announcements here.
We'll get you signed.
You know, I didn't know either until
just logged out.
On his and I know David personally, but I didn't know either until it said on his bio sheet. It said number of kids, and there was a zero, but then the zero was scratched out, and it said one on the way.
Nice.
So we all found out together, guys.
That's pretty good.
Oh, wow. So just a brutal run out here from Mike. Chris ends up rivering the best hand. After Mike had most of the board almost locked.
And just like last time, he does it instantly with that $3 million bet.
Yeah. And so he gets paid off, limo.
So this is the other Mike. Let me try to get some info.
Yeah, this is Nisetta here.
Let me try to give you guys some info on the other Mike here.
Limo's on a heater.
Oh, Limo is on a heater. And Limo's been on a heater this whole tournament. He was the chip leader after all the flights in day one. And that was, you know, impressive in itself after already making the final table in the 2 mil. And here he is back at it, just stacking. There you can see in event number one, 23,000 for his ninth place finish. He's in a great position to do much better than that this time. These guys look like they're having fun. They're having a good time. And 122 big blinds for Limo. Wow, that's a huge stack at a final table in a tournament where at times it got a little shallow.
In one of these $400 tournaments, I mean, this is a pretty deep final table.
Very
look at this.
So,
oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So the very beginning of this tournament, we all started with 100,000 chips, by the way, at 100, 200. So we all started with basically unlimited chips. I don't know how Aaron dusted them off in 20 minutes, but the rest
of
us. So it starts unreal deep, and then it gets pretty shallow in the middle, as, I mean, 30-minute blind structure is going to get. And now it's right at itself. Like, it's back to pretty deep, good structure.
Yeah, and we discussed that earlier about how that happens. Like, last two tables, you have all these chips in play, and then everybody busts, and, like, the average chip stack doubles, but the blinds only go up one level. That's where things start to even out as far as the depth of the tournament. So these guys got chips to play with, and let the best man win.
So Rocco Lucius opened and won that pot, stealing the blinds. Rocco's been around for a while now. He is a local Philly guy, also has two daughters.
Tell him the story about that you told me earlier about Rocco. How
I saw on Twitter this morning, he went home, and I saw that home is Philly, so he drove all the way to Philly just to kiss his daughters for good luck and then drove back? Is that all happened today?
Yeah. Apparently.
What a guy.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. He had to do it. He said it was good luck or something, and he drove home to kiss his daughters to come back and play this tournament. And Rocco is there in sixth place with 30 bigs and a shot.
He's a cash player, cash game grinder, right? He does play for a living.
Cash game grinder, yep. He's from Philadelphia, 35 years old.
He won that a circuit ring in Chester.
Won a circuit ring. His biggest tournament cash is $77,000 at the Parks Big Stack, so... Rocco's been around for a while. I think we're going to, you know, we're definitely, this is what I like about this final table. Not only are they deep, they came in with 50 blinds plus average, but I think these guys are really going to mix it up. They've played a bunch of tournaments before, unlike the opening event where you had a bunch of people who were kind of short and were kind of limited by what their stacks could do. And so, and maybe didn't, were kind of a little bit afraid of, you know, the bubble and the different pay jumps that they were facing. So, here we have Evan. We haven't met just yet. Try to see if I can give you guys some information on
that. I think we have the least info on Evan of anyone.
Right.
But he is wearing headphones on his head, which is a common theme at this final table. I think I've seen three people with headphones on their head, and also their avatar comes up with their headphones on their head, which is kind of cool and funny.
Oh, wow. Yeah, look at those
graphics. Headphones. Look at
our graphics team's pretty good here at the Borgata. Look at that stuff.
Look at Chris Limo just taking it down. He turns a value card, and he's just doing it. He was just doing it. And here's the thing is that if this dude would have seen it, he would have took it down.
So Evan Bell's from Mays Landing, Atlantic City. He's 32 years old. He's been a retail store owner for about 3 years, single. Not married, no kids. He's been playing poker for about 12 years. So this is definitely one of the bigger spots that he's probably going to see.
Yeah.
That he's probably seen in his poker career thus far. So
with it being like his, you know, by far his biggest score and him having no chips, you can expect him to be really tight like he just was in that hand.
Yeah.
By just checking that king-queen after missing the flop.
I played with Evan yesterday. Mm-hmm. Oh, by the way, a little brag. I cashed in this event.
There you go.
Wow, yeah. You're a hero.
I'm very good at poker, yeah. I was like 73rd for 1,700 or something. But
that's a great run.
Yeah, thanks,
that's
buddy.
A great run right there.
I had to battle with Evan a little bit. And, I mean, he was playing a decent amount of pots. He never really got too out of line. I thought... Maybe there was an under-the-gun raise with, you know, an ace-five suited. He had chips. Like, that's, you know, stepping out there a little bit. He's getting after it.
Yeah. Remember, guys, if you guys want to follow along and make this as interactive as possible, please use the hashtag BorgataPokerLive. You can also chat with us on the Twitch and the YouTube stream. We're going to try to get us signed into the YouTube stream, so just be patient with us.
Yeah, I'm looking at we've got some viewers on Twitch, but no... no activities as far as any of the comments. Feel free to
I got the comments up on Twitch over here, and I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah,
you got the comments on Twitch?
Yeah.
He's got the chat.
You got all of them.
Yeah, I'm getting them all.
Oh, wow. You're printing.
Why don't you fire up the YouTube one? See if you're logged into the YouTube one, actually, because he wasn't.
Chris, make
sure we can talk to some people. The other one, the next one.
This is Twitter.
Yeah.
Are you in there? YouTube.
Are you signed in?
I got someone here asking
me. Oh, we've got chat. We've got comments. So
there
now,
you
I
YouTube
see. Okay. I was logged into the wrong thing. We've got tons of comments over here on the YouTube. I'm gonna get to some of you guys.
We got a little bit going on.
I have
here
not
on
been.
Too.
I have not been ignoring you guys. There's been technical difficulties that we've obviously had to run through, but now we're back. So if you guys want to chat, I'll get back to you.
Whoa! Someone has aces in this pot. Yeah. I'm looking at all these comments. I'm not even paying attention to the action.
David actually checked the flop with aces, which is pretty interesting. Unfortunately for him, no one else really has much.
Chris checks.
Expect him to probably bet this straight, but let's see what happens.
What's David D's situation? He's I played with him a couple days ago, and he definitely seemed like he knew what he was doing. I don't know the guy, but he's confident and played well.
Yeah, David DiBenardi was the gentleman I just spoke
DiBenardi,
about.
There you go.
I was also from Ohio, and his previous biggest score to here was a 22K score at the Cleveland Horseshoe.
Okay, I think we're going to see some more out of him.
So
he checked his flop three ways?
Yeah, he did check the flop three ways, and now he's bet
wow.
the turn.
Wow.
Getting fancy.
Sure is getting fancy. The fancy pants play will get you busted every now and again, let me tell you.
Well, Mr. Jackson's also thinking about it, and he...
Mr. Jackson, if you nasty.
That flop check may have actually worked out for him, because it looks like Mr. Jackson's conjuring up something here.
For the people watching on YouTube, we are up as far as the chat goes.
You logged in?
Fire in, and I will respond. Let me see.
Awesome.
Let me just make sure it's a hello
Chris Bolt as well,
to the fans.
There you go.
Oh, I'm logged in as me. Whatever.
Oh, you're logged in as you.
Whatever.
That's fine. We can
it's
handle
fine.
That.
That's totally fine.
I'm gonna chat with everybody.
We'll
personally,
get it all worked out.
You guys get my personal attention.
We'll get it all worked out.
We got a World Series of Poker dealer here, Lucid Dreams, telling us he dealt to David Jackson and sees a big future for him.
There you go.
Nice.
Yeah, David's been around. I've seen him a lot more lately, so he's definitely putting some results together.
I know David. I played a ton with him, and he just shows up everywhere.
So it looks
everywhere.
Like Debo did
Red
take
Sox
that
Nets
down.
5, I see you.
Debo, huh? That's
yeah,
it? That's DiBenardi's nickname, Debo?
That's his all nickname. Right. He took that down with a delayed
Boom.
C-bet there on the turn. And,
okay.
It's a nice pot. So we're still playing 300, 600 with 100K ante. The stakes are pretty big.
I want to see some headphone-on-headphone violence. That's really the only thing I care about is watching two people with headphones go.
Someone here on the Twitch is asking if any of us play online. So,
yeah.
I'll give you the shot to plug your action there, Vinny.
Yeah, well, I mean, I've just moved to New Jersey within the last 12 months, so I've been playing a lot on the local regulated sites here. And while it's you know, no pre-Black Friday, it's, you know, there's definitely been plenty of action. And just so you guys know, the upcoming Garden State Super Series is going to be October 11th to the 25th. And definitely make sure that you log on to BorgataPoker.com and check in for all the current, you know, deposit bonuses and promotions that we're running.
Yeah, that Garden State Super Series is October 11th, 25th. I might even be out here in New Jersey to fire some of these up.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun with a ton of guarantees.
There's a $1,000 buy-in tournament in there.
Yeah, there's some high rollers. There's a $500 buy-in. There's some really, really good tournament. So.
Well, while you guys are firing those tournaments, I'm going to fire up a call to Chris Limo, one of his best limousines, because he is literally printing right now, and he is going to be expanding that limo business really quickly if he keeps it up. Said he min-cashed the main this year. It's much better than I could have ever done, considering I've never cashed the main.
How many times have you played it?
I've played it, six times maybe? Yeah. I started, 2010.
You're due, buddy.
I'm due. I'm due for a cash. All right, Rocco thinking. No, he does not want to play.
He's got the blackjack.
See, now I'm very upset. Rocco has the headphones on in his picture, but he doesn't have the headphones on now. This makes me very upset. I want for my headphone violin.
All right, let's see who we haven't introduced
yet. We got Jay.
I want to make sure that family and friends have their guy.
What do we know about Jay here, guys?
Their guy represented. I'm getting to Jay right now, actually.
Good.
As you mentioned.
We know that Jay's raising a 1.3 with King Jack. And we also know that Limo is literally running his limo over everybody at the moment. He has so much confidence.
Wow, there he goes.
Boom, slamming these chips in so confidently.
So seat six is Jay Cavour. He is from Jersey City. He's a neighbor of mine in Jersey City. He's an investment banker. Been doing it for 10 years. His hobbies are chess. He usually plays at Borgata and Foxwoods. And his biggest previous cash is $55,000. So trying to have the largest score of his career here today. Let's see if he's able to do it. He opens the pot here with King Jack. Gets a call from Chris with King Queen. And Michael Dobbs, the chip leader coming in, defended the big blind, Queen 7 of Diamonds. All looks pretty standard here so far, I would say.
Michael checks. Jay checks. Chris checks as well. Our turn. Jack of clubs. Michael still first to ask.
So Jay looks like turns the best hand here after whiffing the flop. Had the Michael third best checks. Hand on the flop and now has the best hand. So let's see how he...
Can't really fault Chris for not c-betting. His instincts are just right on right now. I mean, he would have ran into Michael. He just had him in bad shape.
Wow.
As I talk about his good instincts, he just pops the guy who just bet with top pair.
Yeah, this is probably not going to work, but again, we're not really too aware of the history between these two players, but I would imagine that Jay would probably find a call, and Michael unfortunately has to fold what was the best hand.
So Jay, by the way, also cashed the $2 million.
Yeah.
He got 90th place the same time that Limo got 9th or 10th, so
Maybe
they played against each other in that tournament.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. A few of these guys actually have cashed in both the big live stream events so far at the Borgata.
And he will make the call. He's got a lot of chips, though. This is going to be a really tough situation for Jay on the river if Chris decides to get crazy.
Yeah, you guys are doing this hand. I'm responding to all these YouTube comments. There's some funny ones up here. They're talking about all sorts of things about how the players are going to be spending their money when they win, if what they get, and a couple of people are just making some personal comments saying, "Hey."
Yeah, I know. I know who Dan is.
Oh yeah.
Can we play a bunch?
Okay, so apparently Vinny here is one of the biggest whales on Borgata Poker. So,
yeah, so
if you really want to win some money and you want
come
an
on,
easy
log
opponent,
in, guys, come on.
He's a whale. Just ask Red Sox Nets. He'll
giving
he'll,
it away
he'll
every
tell
day.
You. He is dumping money on Borgata Poker. So everybody, please get your deposit bonuses now so you can have extra money so that you can fire it.
Get it while it's hot. Get it while it's hot, guys.
Because he'll if you fire all the barrels, he'll probably fold river and you'll win a nice one.
Oh man.
Looks like we got a poll going on who the better Pahuja brother is.
Oh, shocker.
See, I would the better Massey. I mean,
oh, the better Massey brother too.
That's a tough one too. It depends. We're evenly split through the industry. People hate us equally.
Wow. So Jay actually folds 9-10 suited when it folded to him. That's kind of that's a pretty nitty laydown, I would say, with given his stack and position at the table, but. He is taking the conservative approach to
so
start.
So is everybody.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of that.
And here we go. Walk it out.
And
not going to be a lot of that going on at a pro-heavy final table.
Yeah, I was a little surprised to see that. But, again, who knows? Maybe he thinks Rocco defends kind of light and just didn't want to play a pot with him. Not sure.
Short stacks are getting short. Chris Limo's getting big.
There's still plenty of play, though. I mean,
the
opening event, they came in. I think they were a bit shallower than this, so this could be we could be in here for a long night.
I still like the 4 and the 5. They got the most experience, and by that I mean the position. I'm talking about not their seats. Mm-hmm. Kuden and Jackson, as you see right there, these guys are the best players in my opinion. They have the most experience, specifically Kuden. I would say has the most experience, definitely the most results. Even though they are in the middle of the pack, I really like their chances to be in the final three.
So we haven't talked about Mike Nichetta yet. I just wanted to mention him. He's a 33-year-old police marine. He's been doing it for 10 years. He is in seat 5. And although he is a short stack, anything can happen. And this is a big moment for him. His previous biggest cash was only $5,300. So, again, a lot of guys playing for money that you know, they really haven't played for before. So, in the meantime, Jay has opened this pot. We don't know what his cards are.
Yeah, the stream has been a little inconsistent with what the cards are and what when we can see them.
Just have to make sure these guys.
Geraldine Titani has joined the chat on YouTube over here. She's following along with the coverage. She is an avid poker fan and a close personal friend of many in poker, including the BCP team. Glad to have you with us, Geraldine. A lot of action over here in the chat. Feel free to join along, people. Later on, we're going to be doing some giveaways, some hats and stuff. We'll have some games, maybe have some contests or whatever.
Definitely. We have plenty of hats to give out, guys, so stay tuned. Make sure you use that Borgata Poker Live hashtag when you tweet at us so that we can read the tweets and get your comments on air.
And also, if you guys have any ideas of what kind of contests you want us to run or what kind of games you want us to run, feel free to give us some input.
I have a feeling we might see some dirt.
Yeah, let's
show up.
So what? I'm
that's okay.
Engaging. You know, I'm inducing.
We have a ban button, by the way. I've already banned somebody on there.
Did you really?
Yeah, in the Twitch, some guy was just spamming some other site constantly, so he got the boot.
All right, I got to go because I'm going to have to do an interview shortly.
All right.
See you up in a minute. So this is an interesting pot. David D. Debo 3-bet at pre. We just don't know their hole cards.
Oh, it looks wow. Like that Jay is interesting. Let's play along.
Yeah, Jay has called the 3-bet. I believe.
Jay called it out of position, huh?
He opened the pot to, I think, 1.2, and then David made it 2.8.
And then we got a check call
here. And then we have a check call. David down bet to 2.3, and Jay is called. So.
Okay, I think Debo's range is still pretty wide open. And at this point, Jay, I mean, most likely has a pair.
Yeah,
I mean,
you would think that he has.
I would think he probably has an overpair, and not one that he wanted to get in pre-flop, even though Debo doesn't have a ton of chips. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, probably not queens are better, probably not jacks are better.
So we're gonna check on the turn.
Interesting card.
Yeah. And Jay's gonna lead this card, looks like, or he's thinking about it.
I guess there could be clubs in this.
There's
games.
Your preflop action there,
the
top left of your screen, you can see.
4 million.
And David Jay calls, did lead the river, and David's folded, what I guess was maybe ace high or just a hand that bricked in general.
Yeah. I think that's probably a good move for Debo to not continue firing at that. That's looked like a board that would be tough to shake Jay off of if he actually had an overpair, which is what we think he had.
Mm-hmm.
Got updated chip counts here.
Yep.
Two guys over 100 bigs, another guy with 90. Man, that's a lot of chips. There's going to be some interesting turns and rivers. It's not all preflop anymore.
Right. And the guys that are two most experienced, I would say, Dave Jackson and Joey Kuden, are kind of middle of the pack. So I think it's going to be interesting to see. They don't want to kind of drift down towards the bottom of the chip counts, but they also want to try to be aggressive and try to, you know, get towards the top three. So
yeah.
I want to see how these guys particularly navigate the next few hours.
And you say they're the two most experienced. I gotta say, Chris Limo, definitely an experienced player. He's been around. I don't know if he plays a ton of tournaments. I played a little bit of cash with him.
Right.
But he's got a lot of experience under his belt too.
And it looks like the money doesn't really faze him that much either. So that's why he's definitely someone who's a big threat here.
1.3.
Yeah.
Because he does play big cash games, and I don't think he's really too worried about the stakes.
He's got that Northeast tough guy persona, too. We asked him if he was nervous or excited going into this thing. He said, nah, I'm not that excited. Nah, I'm not nervous at all. You know, so those with that persona, you know, tough to move those guys off a pot, too.
So I don't know if we lost our hole card cam somehow, or maybe the RFID is not reading it well. We apologize, guys. We're going to try to get that rectified. There we go.
Hey, look at that.
Okay.
Right on cue.
Just a little bit of a delay there. So
Mike Dobbs got a lot of chips, too.
Yeah, Mike Dobbs is putting some pressure on Chris here with a 3-bet of ace-jack.
Dobbs, another guy that you're not pushing him around too easily. You know, I played a few tournaments with him also. So These two could end up in big collisions. Neither one of them like to budge. They both have good instincts, though.
Yep. Chris let it go, and Mike's going to take that one down. The one thing I think that's really going for Chris in this tournament is his position. He has a great seat at this table. A lot of the guys who are really aggressive and really experienced as they get short and shorter handed, those guys are on his right. I think that's really gonna benefit him.
Yeah. He does have Debo on his left, and I think, is that correct?
Yeah, but Debo's not that deep, I think. So
yeah.
I think unless Debo does double or chip up a bit, he may not present too much of a problem. But we'll see. Anything can happen at these final tables, and usually does.
Jay's not getting out of line. That 10-9 is suited. He let go. The ace 4 suited under the gun. I mean, I like this one. The other one, I would have got involved probably with the 10-9 suited, but that's not so bad. I mean, if you don't want to get involved with that, you don't have to.
Right.
I like Kelly, the announcer, calling David Jackson, just calling him easy, you know? If you have a nickname, that might be a little intimidating to other players. Like, this guy's got a nickname. He could be. Could be something to be scared of.
Joey making a standard shove here, small blind versus big blind. Just setting Mike in. I believe Mike has less than 15 big blinds, so pretty standard play there, I'd say.
Yeah.
And Mike just can't do much there with the 10 high.
You know how many big blinds Mike has in the setup?
I don't. I believe it's less than 15. I know it just came up there a little while. I know he's in the bottom third of the chip counts.
Wow, look at Kooten's career earnings there. Almost 900,000. This could put him up over a million, right? Yeah. What's first place in this thing?
First place in this tournament is 169. So
maybe second could put him up over a million, maybe?
Yep, second is 109.
Might. They said nearly 900, so.
Yeah, like
that's
said,
a cool little benchmark.
Joey's really been hot lately, so you know, he's riding out this heater, and I think he wants nothing more than to cap it off by taking down this title. So, but your series has been okay, right? You've had two. You picked up two caches already.
Yeah.
Final table.
Yeah, it was okay. Final table, the elevator, which was interesting format. You know, we started with a normal amount of chips, maybe a little high, but then the blind started at
5 minute levels, 10 minute levels.
10 minute levels, yeah. And every two levels that we gained 5 more minutes. We started with 10, then it was 15, then 20, and we started with 40,000 chips at 2550. So at the beginning, you start crazy deep, which is kind of a signature of Tab here at the Borgata. They like to start with a lot of chips, and then in the smaller buy-ins, it kind of gets down to a short stack tournament in the end.
Right.
In the big buy-ins, it stays deep kind of the whole way.
Yep.
And the elevator, just by the format, it ends up getting deep towards the end of the tournament.
Tough spot there for Rocco. That's kind of tough. He did have a overpair to Evan's threes, but with at least four or five guys left to act, it's kind of hard to.
I like that fold.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to put your chips into those sixes and really just disrupt any kind of stack pressure you could put on people in the future. So I like that fold as well. And Evan being the shortest stack is a no-brainer with a pair and picks up some very, very necessary blinds in the end.
Yeah. So that elevator tournament we were talking about, Kyle Bowker, who's a buddy of mine, we used to play fantasy football together, he ended up winning the tournament.
Yeah.
And, I mean, he played really well, had aces about 20 times, so I mean, that helps. I'm just going to tell some bad beat stories while I'm here.
Yeah. No, Kyle's been around for a while, so was happy to see him. Anyway, it's a bunch of players at that final table who, you know, I would have been very happy to see win that tournament.
Yeah, it was tough.
So yeah, as we said, these players started with 100,000 chips a few days ago. And the interesting part about this structure was that there was antes from the start, which I think, you know, at least from the professional standpoint, we like to see because no one wants to play so many levels without antes. So
yeah, especially if you start really deep. Mm-hmm. If you're starting short, kind of like the World Series events do, you don't start super deep. I think it's okay to play a little bit with no antes in the beginning.
Right.
But when you're starting
this deep,
exceptionally deep,
right.
make the pots count, you know?
Exactly. So here we have Mike Dobbs opening, 1.4 million with the ace jack.
And that structure also might benefit a guy like Chris Limo, who plays a lot of cash, or who else? There's another cash game pro here.
Rocco
Luciano, yeah. He plays a lot of cash. So those guys are used to playing pretty deep, you know? So at the beginning of the tournament, they could really do some damage. Where the, you know, the tournament professionals, a lot of the tournament professionals are really used to having 20 to 40 big blinds, and they're so this kind of structure may benefit these cash game guys a little bit.
Sure. And like we said, they came in with an average stack of around 57 million at, 27 million at the 500K big blind. So plenty of play here to start. And here we have Jay with the ace king in the small blind, three betting to 3.1 million.
He's three betting a under the gun or under the gun one raiser.
Yeah.
It looks pretty strong to me. I don't know if Michael's feeling that.
Mike may still call here. He may just want to see three in position and test him a little bit. We'll see. Yeah, I had a feeling he was going to call here. Ace Jack's kind of, you know,
Michael
feels like a hand that's too good to fold, but not too good to, you know, to four
bet. I understand those spots.
Yeah,
I mean,
so
I'd much rather have a 10-9 suited than an ace jack in that
sure.
spot, especially when a guy looks like he has it, you know?
Sure. So this is always interesting. Neither player has a pair in a three bet pot, so we'll see who's able to win it.
Michael does have the ace of diamonds. I don't know how much that means to them at this point with the backdoor flush draw.
I'd imagine he'd probably call one, right? I mean, I think that with the backdoor diamond, you know, nut flush draw, I think he's probably going to peel one card here.
Yeah, maybe. Put a little pressure on.
Yeah, but let's see what happens. Wow, Jay did c-bet pretty big there. 5 million. That's pretty sizable c-bet, so not much there for Mike to do but fold, so.
Guess who's back?
How'd that go?
Again.
No, but we won't ruin it to tell everyone who you interviewed.
Tell
we'll
a friend.
We'll let them just see it in a little bit.
Of course.
Glad you're back.
Yeah, I love to be back.
Did you have fun?
I like being in the action.
Right, well, don't neglect your people here.
Oh, my people.
Yeah, your
hello, people. Sorry, I've been gone.
Yeah, they're missing you.
I was doing some sideline interviewing. I enjoy it. I think I have a new calling in life. I might not play poker anymore. I might just be sideline personality. Let me go back and see what's up with my people. Gerilyn. Yes. How are you? Got Thomas Brown asking me where Baseman's at. My boy Baseman is back in Cincinnati where he lives. He's hanging out. He's just bought a house. He's becoming an adult.
We got two guys here from Ohio.
Yeah, and we do have two guys here from Ohio, one being Kuden.
Yep. And the other being Debo.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Phil. Phil says we got a great stream going.
Good. Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Joe, Mike, and Jay have all folded. Now to Chris.
See, did we get through everybody's bios? I don't want to miss anybody and then have them bust and then we didn't get a chance to introduce them. So let me make sure we covered everybody here. I think we did. Evan, Lux, Luciano. You didn't have any bios, right? Yeah.
Big line will raise.
Million on top.
So here we have a limp from Chris Limo for 600K, and Debo is taking his option to raise it up on a good one.
Chris is not scared. Two flop top pair.
Well, 10 of spades. Chris checks.
See if Debo decides to put the standard C bet in here or if he's going to take one off.
That's a ragged enough flop. He might just go ahead and see that, even against a sticky opponent like Chris.
Yeah, but Chris Limo is printing on every hand.
Yeah, you got to factor that in.
1.1 and an all-in.
Oh, wow, and
he snapped
just snapped
in.
That's probably gonna work.
Limo, riding his limo over everyone's soul at the moment. Comfortable, no problem. He knows that he would have been snapped by an overpair by now and that he's good. And he's
David Bowles and Chris will win the pot.
Hello.
Yeah, Chris does not seem to be fazed by the moment whatsoever. He's
and his opponent not too thrilled.
That's frustrating when you're Debo there. You have a hand that you should probably raise when it's limped. You know the guy's not folding that often, but it's just strong enough hand. Then you're going to see bet the ragged board. He probably didn't hit it. Then he just rips it all in. I mean,
not much you can do there.
No, and it's so demoralizing when he just snap does it. Like, it's
like he was doing it whether he flopped it or not, you know?
And there's nothing you can do. So helpless. Happens to me all the time.
Turns out Debo, he just had it. Don't worry about it, buddy.
Yeah. Ooh, frustrated chip release there. Not thrilled, but.
Well, he just lost a quarter of his stack, unfortunately. But
what do you guys know about this David?
Well, we know that he's from Ohio and his nickname is Debo. The other information.
I didn't get a chance to go over all of the bios.
Yeah. I played with him a little bit in this tournament, and I didn't get to see a ton of hands or anything, but he has a confidence about him. He knows what he's doing.
Definitely.
Seems like he knows what he's doing.
Yeah, he looks pretty strong. His table presence is solid.
Some guys here on the Twitch and YouTube feed have called him the best player by far. I don't know.
Okay.
I
mean, really?
I'm sure they don't know how everyone plays, but they're fans anyway.
They must not know Joey Kuden then.
They must not. Not a lot of players can be much better than Joey Kuden.
Well, one thing about David that no one probably knows is that he was a little league state champion in Ohio when he was 12. So that's a pretty cool fun fact.
Looks like an athlete. Look at him.
That he decided to share with us. If he wins the event, he says that he'd like to invest in something and buy a new car, maybe even go to Costa Rica with some friends. So.
I mean, he's probably early 20s, right?
Yeah.
We'll give him a break for only having one 20K score. Like he's gonna make some more scores.
Yeah,
this is one right here.
He's got plenty of time.
Yeah, and he's playing well. I mean, he did what he had to do in that Queen Jack hand. He just got kind of screwed.
He just got outflopped. It happens.
No, I mean he's doing a good job. Whatever.
That board is definitely a board that's not going to hit Chris.
This poker thing is just so ridiculous. This whole game is just, it's all a joke anyways. So you just got to just do your job and hope that something works out for you.
Wow, and Evan did make it pretty nitty fold there with King 10 in the big blind to a cutoff open.
Yeah, but it's also a cutoff open from a guy who hasn't bet at all today.
Evan has 14 blinds, and he's going to try to use them in a different spot. So
there's really only three guys in like massive danger zone, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
and they're not even,
and then there's three guys who have all the chips.
Right.
Yeah. But those middle guys are doing all right.
Yep.
The three middle guys are the best. But I mean, when it comes to, you know, who you think is going to win the tournament, I mean, you got to go with whoever has all of the chips at the moment, who's running the hottest, because that's really what it comes down to.
Sure.
It's who runs the hottest in this spot.
Absolutely.
You know, anything could happen as far as like one of the good players getting cooler or somebody making one mistake. You know, if David or Joey, who are in the middle of the pack, you know, they lose one hand, whether it's something they did or something they couldn't avoid, like they're all of a sudden they're out of it.
Well, these are the three guys that all have the similar stacks.
Yeah, all in a row.
David and Joey all have 30 to 35 bigs, so I think it's going to be really interesting to see how those guys kind of navigate the next, you know, few hours, because they're really going to have to try to get shorthanded, but at the same time they don't want to double up the guys who have 14 bigs. They have 14 bigs, you know.
Yeah.
So it's going to be very interesting to see what spots they decide to get involved and what spots they don't.
They really only have about 10 more minutes before it goes to 400, 800, then that 30 big blinds comes a lot less.
Exactly. So
David Jackson grinding as he always does. This is his MO in his career.
I'll make a bet for a beer with either one of you guys if you want. I'll take those three guys that we all think are the best right there, those three in a row, and you guys can have the top two chip count guys. Just win only.
I'll do it for a beer.
All right,
win only? Must win?
Yeah,
must
it's a win.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a must win bet. You got, wow, I like your side here, but I'm going to, just for the sake of this beer, I am going to bet you that either Limo or Jay take it down.
And remember, guys, this is a big weekend coming up here at the Borgata, so if you haven't been here in a while, we have the flagship WPT starting off on Sunday. We have a 1K6 Max on Friday.
That 1K6 Max is one of my favorite tournaments in the stop anywhere, because you start pretty deep, the rounds are deep. Like, it's one of the deepest tournaments there is.
And it's a 200K guarantee, don't forget.
Yeah,
it's
a big guarantee.
Close to 300 players probably for it.
Because it's six-handed, you get a lot of stacks colliding early, you know?
Exactly.
So the stacks are just really deep in the middle of the tournament. So
not to mention how comfortable it is to sit at the table when they're not 9-10 handed.
Yeah, that's a good point, too.
If you haven't visited the Borgata to play poker, this is the weekend to come. There's a lot of action. Cash games running all day.
What we got here? We got a 14 big blind shove with the queen 10 and the cutoff. That's
David D.
Uh-oh. Well, Mike Hobbs, unfortunately.
I don't think Mike's going to find a fold here.
For Debo.
I don't know, man.
Has walked into it.
This is a tough spot for Michael. Just kidding.
He seems to be trying to. Oh, okay, well, he did.
He's just trying to wrap the big blind in.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Trying to say maybe he can get a little more.
Run whatever he's.
We're going to get a sweat here. This isn't going to be that clean. We're going to get at least a sweat.
Debo's going to need some help. So we have the queen 10 for David, the aces for Michael.
Oh my goodness, that was wrong.
Not much of a sweat.
That is pretty much the worst flop for David. He's getting his bag together.
Even worse turn. Not a sweat at all.
Wow.
Good game for the youngster.
Yeah, we'll see about around again.
He never had a shot, and it's only because of the cards. It's not because of his skill. He just that queen jack hand. You know, it's kind of just a stupid spot for him, and then him shoving the queen 10 is fine, and you just wasn't his day.
Yeah.
But I'm sure he'll have much better days as a young kid. He's got good presence at the table, and, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if he was back in another final table soon.
What do you think of that queen 10 shove, especially with Evan on his left being so short, too? You think that maybe he could have waited a little bit, or do you think that's pretty standard for 14 bigs?
I mean, there could be some kind of ICM nonsense about moving up a spot or something, but. You know, to me, we represent the Borgata, so I'm not going to swear, but F that. Like, come on. I just want to win the tournament. Like, I don't really think about that stuff very much.
Fair enough, yeah.
Well, Debo plays in Florida near Tampa. He's a Tampa Hard Rock guy.
We do lose David DiBernardi in his place. Great run. And he's getting $14,561 for his effort.
Hello.
Is that eighth or ninth that he got?
It was a hello.
Is that ninth or eighth? I'm sorry.
We've got a chat here.
That was ninth place.
Ninth place, excuse me, guys.
ZZZ Rabbit asks.
Ninth place for 14,561.
Aaron and Vinny, talk about what it takes during the middle stages of a tournament to build a stack so you have a chance to make the final table. Well, Vinny?
I think a lot of these questions end up being very table dependent. So, like, if you have someone on your right who you know is raising a lot of pots and trying to steal, you can kind of attack that person. If you're playing at a table that's full of, you know, recreational players who are pretty nitty, well, then you should try to be stealing some blinds more and putting pressure on them. I think the key to middle stages is really to just keep progressing and keep trying to stay ahead of those blind games. And but again, table dynamics, I think, dictate all that stuff.
Sure, sure. You see, I agree with you there. But I really think that the key is to win your all-ins. If you win your all-ins in the middle stages of a tournament, you'll most likely get to the later stages of a tournament. So what you got to do is you got to go all-in, and you got to win. And that's definitely the way to do it, no doubt. I mean, that's where I've had most of my success is when I go all-in and win in the middle stages. So.
Let's see what's my answer. We have some action here. I missed the pre-flop, unfortunately. So
we've got a little bit of a.
Oh, it looks like looks like Mike limped.
We have a limp from the button.
Yeah, for 6 minutes.
We have a raise with the nines by Rocco, right. And now DJ has now made it 4.2.
Call. You didn't hear that? Oh. Well, it looks like Mike limped the button, and Rocco raised it up, and now David Jackson actually 3-bet.
He 3-bet, and Rocco called.
Rocco called, and is now checked the flop.
Three on this 3-4-4. David Jackson's got to love that flop for to continue. You know, as far as representing what he's representing, but unfortunately, Rocco, he's got it. He's got a hand that he's never folding right here. You can see he's just sitting there waiting for David to put his chips in, because whatever he puts in. Rocco's going to call.
At least.
At the minimum. But there's no doubt that Easy wants a fold here.
You're right, though. It actually is a good board for David.
It's a great board.
You can't imagine that Rocco has an overpair, but he, in fact, does have an overpair.
So here you go. $5 million in a call. Interesting hand developing.
Played this hand pretty good.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. So now that's going to just open up more outs for David. He's got to still like his hand.
Wow, they check.
Now check back.
I like the check back there. Just try to get there. You're not sure if you're good or not, you know.
So now Rocco's gonna do something here. I don't know if he's gonna. He just shoves.
Rocco announces all in.
He just shoves.
Wow.
And I'd like to know what he shoved for him. It's 7.8, and it's just standard. wow, it's gonna honestly be hard for Easy to fold here because What is, you
it
know,
depends.
If
you gotta think that Rocco's peeling on the flop with either a flush draw or ace high.
Right.
If you're
a
gonna
lot.
Call here. Yeah.
A lot. So like, so 7. These the turn to river don't really help him. I feel yeah, for.
Don't you think Rocco shoved
David
a flush
Jackson
draw on him though on the flop? I almost
most
think
likely,
had,
yeah.
If he had like a jack ten of spade, queen jack of spade type of hand, I think he would just shove the flop on him, give him their stack. So. I don't know if he has a flush draw that often, but it's hard to really give him a strong hand, honestly, the way this was played out.
Yeah, because it looks like he has a hand like sixes
yeah.
through tens, and like he's not shoving that river
right.
with sixes through tens.
And this
exactly.
Is
he is with nines, but he's not with sixes through tens, so you might think.
This is a weird hand. I don't mind David for being confused here because he just would expect Rocco to four bet his bigger pairs pre.
I
right?
think this
so
is
it's
like.
This is the top of Rocco's range, I think, that he would play this way.
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is just really unlucky that Rocco hit the nine because it would have went snap, check, check on the river, if not.
Yeah, on most runouts, yes.
Yeah,
I would agree with
so
that.
So now his shove looks bluffy.
Yeah, it does look bluffy.
Because his nine's full is so camouflaged, and you know what? Like this would I think it would be more of a hero fold than a hero call.
Oh, look at that. Who's that in the background?
All right, it's on a little bit of a delay, but I'm heading down right now. So it's just ahead.
That's
here
pretty
I come.
Good.
Some of them looks remarkably
I'm going
like
to go down and interview someone on break. Be back.
Let's see.
Rough spot right here.
Yeah, this is a rough spot.
I mean, you do have to put Rocco on peeling with ace high on the flop. That's the only way you can call here is if you think he would do that. And a lot of players would.
The thing is, even if he decides to turn a hand into a bluff, a hand like sixes into a bluff maybe, it still beats David's hand, you know? So David really, the problem is he doesn't, Rocco's not repping much, but David doesn't beat much.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's a really tough spot for David here. But I don't mind him being in the tank here. I just think Rocco is going to shove the flop, I think, with most of his flush draws and overcards. So it's hard to give him a hand that.
I mean, the king, ace, queen peels, you know, those exist. There's a lot of players that make that play. I think that's what David's thinking
absolutely.
Right now, is that Rocco's the type that might peel with those hands.
Absolutely.
We know that guy standing with a microphone in the background. We know that guy would peel with those hands. He's not just folding ace-queen on that flop, you know?
That's fine.
Yeah.
It's a big spot here for David Jackson. Like we said, he was one of those medium stacks that we were talking about. Didn't want to kind of put himself in that danger zone, but still wanted to have a chance to win the tournament. So this is a big inflection point for him. If he calls here and loses, and we know he's going to lose if he calls,
yeah,
he's in trouble.
So he also he plays a lot of live tournaments. So he puts a lot of stock into physical tells, physical reads, and he did stare Rocco down a lot there. So he might have picked up some weakness or some strength, who knows.
Mm-hmm. He's just having a really hard time putting Rocco on a value hand. I don't blame him here.
This right, that's a really good point.
It's a really, really hard spot for Rocco to have a strong hand.
Yeah, I mean, he's shoving maybe tens. That's like the worst hand he's shoving.
And that's the thing. I think he just may just get that in pre. So I think this is really the top of his range that he plays
like
this
the,
way.
Yes, the
calls
only
the
thing.
Three bet
yeah.
And you know decides to just keep.
I mean,
the pot
or
as small
maybe
as
also
possible.
Like fives, fours, and threes.
Perhaps.
Like that's it.
Yeah.
Also, but
yeah.
I mean, you can throw those out the window. At least that's how I play poker.
And the thing is, Rocco might even limp those hands pre because what's his name called? He may have just completed with the smaller pairs as well. You know.
Yeah.
He may
man.
Not have even raised. So it's like, this is why David's in such a tough spot here. I think is because he's really having a hard time putting him on a hand.
Yeah, that's
I
a really,
really don't
good
blame
point.
Him. This is a tough spot, but let's see if he can figure out the right answer.
I just heard him say, you know, I feel like you have ASI. You just called the flop with
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Rocco's really giving him a stare down. I mean, there's no real reason for it. But I guess he's.
While in the middle, I'm going to look for see if anyone's tweeting to the Borgata hashtag and see if we can get some more interaction with our viewers.
This doesn't count the break yet, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Call. Wow, I made the call.
He did call. Wow.
Nice call.
Rocco's pretty pumped about that one.
When do we come back? 4.
Easy.
It's 4:17.
4:30. Play over Zoom at 4:30.
Oh, late.
It's 7.8.
We'll start without you.
Six.
Well, David loses 17 million in that hand.
It's 7.8.
So he's going to be our new tournament short stack, unfortunately, for him. And Rocco is going to shoot up the leaderboard a little bit, probably to the top 4. We'll get those updated for you shortly.
Yeah, that's weird.
Are you on the Twitch or you're over? So here are your updated chip counts. David Jackson bringing up the rear with 10 big blinds. And we're gonna head down to Aaron Massey in a bit and have him interview Rocco Luciano.
All right, we're actually going to take a break here with these guys taking a break. We'll be back in 15 minutes. I'm not sure if Aaron's interview is coming up in the break or after. Can we get that from the back?
Chris Limo is still our leader with 120 big blinds. And these guys are going to take a short break.
All right, I'm here with Rocco Luciano. You just won a huge pot against David Jackson. Tell me a little bit about what happened in the hand.
Well, I've been playing really tight. I haven't played any hands, and we played all day yesterday. The button, who's a big stack, he limped the button, and I raised, and he like 3-bet me min. I had pocket nines. The button folded. I called out of position. It was a 4-4 three flop, I believe, or something like that. I check called the flop. It went 5 turn, check on the turn, and then I hit the boat on the river, and I just jammed all in, and he kind of hero called me with pocket deuces.
Yeah, well, he thought about it there for a long time. I seen you there. You're obviously begging for a call now that the hands are face up. What were you thinking while he was tanking?
I don't know. I was trying. I'm not a big tough guy, but I tried to put my tough guy look on, and I was staring him down. I don't know. I showed a bluff against him. I showed a 3 and a 3-bet pot yesterday. I was hoping he thought of that hand and knew I was capable of, you know, bluffing it off.
So you're trying to do a little live pro stuff. That's cool. We understand that. There's a lot of that goes on the East Coast. You're a live grinder. Is that right? You play with some cash in some tournaments?
Yeah. I mean, I don't do it full time. But, you know, I play a lot, and I'm pretty proud of my success considering the volume that I put in. I play at parks predominantly. I play a lot of cash games, 2-5, sometimes 10-10. You know, and I play, you know, little tournaments on the East Coast. I don't travel. I have two little baby girls and a wife, and I also have a business. I work. I'm a real estate appraiser. So, but I play more than the average person. I won't call myself a pro, but I'm pretty somewhere in between pro and amateur.
Well, you certainly know what you're doing, making it to this final table, and now having a big stack, putting your live pro on. Now, you said that you have two girls and a wife. Tell us a little bit about this, about what you did this morning before the final table for good luck.
Well, it was a mixture. I woke up early, about 8 o'clock, and I wanted to, I was here, I live in Philly about an hour away, and I wanted to go home and kiss my two little daughters, my daughter Gianna and Gabriella, who are my heart, and I wanted to give them a kiss, good luck before, maybe they can, you know, give me some run good, and, you know, I had some work to do, actually. I actually worked this morning and did an appraisal.
Wow, that's nuts.
Yeah, so, you know, I try to do the right things, you know, and, you know, so happy to see my two little girls. I love them. They ever watch this, if right now they don't understand, but
they'll be able to see it later in life, though. They know that daddy loves them, and you know what, apparently you guys helped him put that 9 on the river there, so you guys will be able to see this when you guys know what's going on. It'll be on YouTube and whatever for a long time, and so I'm just happy to see you here. Hope it looks like you're having a good time, and it looks like you're really enjoying yourself.
I am. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
All right, man, good luck to the rest of the way. All right, we'll get back to the action shortly.
Loving up on the Puglets and looking down on 4 Kings. Now that's a win. Showing off your soft top and shoving in on a straight flush. Now that's a win. Manning the tongs and taking down a hot tournament. Now that's a win. Do what you love and get the thrill of Borgata anytime and anywhere in New Jersey. Play online, poker, slots, blackjack, real money. TheBorgata.com. Now that's a win. Get $20 to play when you sign up now.